Mandeville, and today I'm going to be talking to you about some work that I've been doing at the University of Wyoming, working on repeated hybridization between Yellowstone cutthroat trout and rainbow trout. So this work is a... That's not a trout. So this work is in collaboration with several people, with Katie Wagner, who's in this room right now, and her dog Kiwi's our good field assistant, Annika Walters, Jason Burkhart from the Wyoming Game and Fish Department, and two wonderful undergrads, Carly Higgins on the left and Brittany Nordberg on the right. So we have a couple reasons that we're interested in doing this work, and the first is that we'd really like to know, across the range where a pair of species interacts, how consistent reproductive isolation is, and what mechanisms maintain reproductive isolation. For this particular project, there's also a distinct conservation application. We'd really like to know how native fish, in this case the Yellowstone cutthroat trout, are affected by hybridization with non-native fish, in this case rainbow trout. So when related species come into secondary contact, we know that there are a variety of outcomes that we might expect. And so a first possibility is that if they've been evolving long enough in allopatry and have evolved full reproductive isolation, we could have a situation where close relatives come back together and reproductive isolation is entirely maintained. Now, since we're in a reproductive isolation and hybridization session, most of you are also well aware that it's quite possible that hybridization will occur when related species come to secondary contact. Or perhaps that in some locations or throughout the species range, there could be a collapse of parental species. So we've acknowledged this variation in outcomes that can occur when secondary contact occurs. But one thing that we're still really working on quantifying is how consistent reproductive isolation is across space, across multiple locations, where a pair of species meets. And so we've traditionally thought of reproductive isolation as kind of a species level thing, where if there's a single basis of reproductive isolation between a pair of species, we could see a scenario where hybridization is consistent across locations, like in this hypothetical river network. But increasingly, we're getting evidence that hybridization can vary. And so I'd like to set up two different ways that we might expect hybridization to vary. One is that the incidence of hybridization can vary. We could have a scenario where in some tributaries there's hybridization and in some there's not. Or we could have a scenario where extent of hybridization varies. In some tributaries there's no hybridization, in some there's a little bit, and in some there's a lot. So keep this framework in mind as we go through this talk. So this specific study, which has been cut off despite my editing, is that rainbow trout, the second picture down, have been introduced into the range of Yellowstone cutthroat, this next picture up. And so if we look at this range map, Yellowstone cutthroat is native only to this orange area. The pink area is where it's been introduced. Rainbow trout is only native to this yellow area on the west coast, but has been introduced across North America and across the world as well. Rainbow trout are known to hybridize with a whole bunch of cutthroat trout where they overlap, including this is a Yellowstone cutthroat rainbow trout hybrid caught by our lab undergrad, Brittany Nordberg. This process of rainbow trout introduction is really quite impressive. There's been extensive stocking of rainbow trout throughout the world from the 19th century to the present. This photo is a little bit dark, but these guys have old-fashioned milk jugs and are dumping trout into a stream somewhere. This is cool. I like this little historical element here. Back to this work, away from my historical digression. So for this work, we're trying to figure out the extent of Yellowstone cutthroat trout and rainbow trout hybridization in the North Fork Shoshone River drainage to characterize variation among tributaries, like this one and others like it, and also, if possible, to identify mechanisms for reproductive isolation. So we're working here in northwest Wyoming. We're working in the North Fork Shoshone, which is just east of Yellowstone, just west of Cody, Wyoming. You might have been through there on vacation. So the trout in this system have a particular life history. They overwinter in Buffalo Bill Reservoir here. And then in the spring, they migrate up from the reservoir through the main stem. You can see the main stem right there. And into these little tributaries that you see going off to either side. There are tons of tiny tributaries. And so based on work in other systems, it looks like the rainbow trout spawn first, and then about a month later, the Yellowstone trout come up and spawn. But clearly there is some overlap, because we do see a lot of morphologically identified hybrids in the system. And kind of the impetus for this work is to see how far it goes. And in the sad words of our agency collaborators, if there are any Yellowstone cutthroat left to save. So, and then in the fall, the juveniles out-migrate from these tributaries when they're about this big, and go down into the reservoir and main stem for the winter. So last fall, we sampled over 1,100 fish from 26 different tributaries of the North Fork Shoshone River. We used backpack electrofishing for the fish buster unit up here. And we sampled 40 to 60 individuals per tributary. And cool thing about sampling for this project is that we were able to sample juveniles. So look at the size of this fish relative to the size of this finger. So these juveniles are definitely some sort of trout species, but we can't tell whether they're Yellowstone cutthroat or rainbow trout at this size. And so as much as possible, we're collecting a random sample of the juvenile trout in that system, which I like because it means that we're not cherry picking things that look like parents or look like hybrids. We're just getting a sample of who's there. And it turns out that there are a lot of fish in all of these tributaries. So these blue tributaries over here were our high priority tributaries where we thought that we had important habitat for Yellowstone cutthroat or rainbow trout spawning. But it looks like even the smaller tributaries, these second priority and third priority tributaries, actually have abundant juvenile rainbow trout, so we might have a lot more spawning habitat than we were originally thinking of. And for our study of how consistent reproductive isolation is, that's great because we get more tributaries, more replicates. So for the rest of this talk, since I just started analyzing this data on June 1st, I'm going to be talking about only a subset of these tributaries, Blackwater, Clearwater, and Eagle Creek. You'll have to come back next year and see the next round of this. But I'm excited about the new results, so I wanted to share our initial genomic data. So with Carly's help, I extracted DNA. Carly extracted most of the DNA. We did library prep. Sequenced it on, in the case of the results here, one lane of Illumina-HiSeq. There's six more lanes representing the other 23 tributaries and reference populations. We had single end 150 base pair reads. We've assembled them to the Atlantic salmon region, and for this first pass, we have 8,500 SNPs that we'll be working with. So, and to jump right into the results, the first thing we see here is from entropy, which is a clustering analysis, somewhat like structure, but with allowing genotype uncertainty and better quantification of uncertainty of the proportion of ancestry, we see that there's a lot more of this yellow ancestry, rainbow trout, than there is of the Yellowstone cutthroat ancestry over here. And so in the three tributaries that we're looking at so far, we see very different distributions of parental and hybrid offspring. And this is really rainbowy, and because these are randomly selected individuals, we can pretty confidently say that there are a lot more juvenile rainbow trout in these systems. And in fact, we only see pure parental Yellowstone cutthroat in one of these tributaries so far. So not looking good for the native fish, but interesting from an evolutionary perspective. And another thing that I'd like to note is that backcrossing is primarily toward Yellowstone cutthroat trout. So we have these triangle plots that have that proportion of ancestry metric along the x-axis. So proportion Yellowstone cutthroat trout. So we have 0% Yellowstone cutthroat down here. And this y-axis of the genome has a copy from each parent. And so you'd have interspecific ancestry of one. And so by plotting proportion of ancestry across against interspecific ancestry, we can begin to get a look at the histories of hybridization that might have produced these fish. And so again, we have rainbow down this corner, Yellowstone cutthroat in that corner. F1's there, back crosses along the sides, along those gray lines that look quite faint in the projection. And in the center, we have F2s or maybe later generation hybrids. Mm-hmm. So from Eagle Creek, it looks like we've got both parental species, some F1s, and a kind of blur of ancestry from a lot of the rainbow to maybe two-thirds or rainbow and, one-third rainbow. And then in the other two tributaries we've got so far, we have a lot more Yellowstone cutthroat ancestry. We don't see any F1s in the case of Blackwater or any back crosses to Yellowstone cutthroat. And so based on work done in the Snake River Basin with these species, we think that hybrids might spawn at a similar time to rainbow trapped. And so that would be a pretty clear-cut cause, a clear-cut mechanism for reproductive isolation in the system that might cause this asymmetric back crossing that we see. However, if we are thinking that these parental species spawn at different times, with the rainbow spawning earlier, and if we think that they have roughly similar growth rates, we might expect to see some relationship of size representing time since birth for them to grow with ancestry of the fish. And so if that were the case, we'd expect things that are zero here that have more rainbow ancestry to be larger. We don't see that, at least in these three tributaries. We're not entirely ruling this out at this point, though, because, as I said, this work was kind of this genomic data is really new, and we have 23 more tributaries to look at. So something exciting that we've got going on this summer is that Brittany Nordberg up here is up in Cody, Wyoming, as we speak, taking videos of spawning fish moving up the tributaries. So this is So what we saw is something that looked much more rainbowy in the front, and then a fish that looks like either a Yellowstone cutthroat or a hybrid with Yellowstone cutthroat moving up in the back. And so we're trying to get an on-the-ground perspective on how these fish are moving within these tributaries. So this is work in progress. We would like to pin down this mechanism of reproductive isolation because that will help us understand the outcomes we see of variation and hybridization. We'd also like to see how consistent hybridization is across years, and maybe even how consistent hybridization is along a tributary, whether we've got might habitat segregation along a tributary in some locations perhaps. And Brittany's work will also help us start to get at that. Okay. So I'd like to thank our funding sources and everybody who helped us do the sampling blitz last fall. It was 2 weeks of snow and grizzly bears and backpack electrofishing, but we got all the fish sampled. And I'll happily take any questions either now or after the talk.
So is the Yellowstone cutthroat doomed to extinction by hybridization, or can you give us some hope?
I'm reluctant to declare anything doomed, especially with 3 weeks of data analysis. I hope it's not. But as we, like, I think behind your question is the point that, yeah, we've got a pretty serious demographic issue for the Yellowstone cutthroat if any hybrid ancestry causes them to back cross to rainbow. So I'm hoping that habitat heterogeneity hybridization dynamics might mean that in some places, there's not this demographic spiral of doom, but we'll see after next year. Okay, I'll talk to anybody else afterwards. I think next talk has to go. Thanks.